utilize your aspect of speaking apathetically.
The bones which encircle the neck beneath the skin is directly
talking about, explained it to others, and had completely settled in definite opinions about us. I must confess that, at such times, I often recalled my own first meeting with G in the evening with the Moscow group. I also, at that time, had been very near passing a ready judgment on G and his pupils. Something had stopped me then. And now, when I had begun to realize what a tremendous value these ideas had, I became almost terrified at the thought of how easily I could have passed them by, and how easily I could have known nothing would ever achieve existence, or how easily I could have again lost sight of him if I had not asked then whether I could see him again. In almost every one of those lectures he reverted to a theme which he evidently considered to be the utmost important thing, but it was very difficult for many of us to assimilate these conclusions. There are, he said, two lines along which man's development proceeds, the line of knowledge and the line of being. In right evolution, the line of knowledge and the line of being are done simultaneously, parallel to and helping one another. The line of knowledge gets too far ahead of the line of being, or if the line of being gets ahead of the line of knowledge, man's development is wrong, and sooner or later it must come to a standstill. He could understand what knowledge means, and may understand the possibility of different levels of knowledge. They understand that knowledge may be lesser or greater, that is to say, of one quality or of another quality. They do not understand that in relation to being, being for them means simply existence, which is just non-existence. They do not understand that being or existence may be of very different levels and categories. Take for instance the being of a mineral and of a plant. It is a different being. The being of a plant and of an animal is again a different being. The being of an animal and of a man is a different being. But the being that two people can differ from one another more than the being of a mineral and of an animal. This is exactly what people do not understand. And they do not understand that knowledge depends on being. Not only do they not understand this latter, but they definitely do not wish to understand it. And especially in Western culture, it is considered that a man may possess great knowledge. For example, he may be an able scientist, make discoveries, advance science, and at the same time he may be, and have the right to be, a petty, egoistic, caviling, mean, envious, vain, naive, and absent-minded man. It seems to be considered here that a professor must always forget his umbrella everywhere. And yet it is his being, and people think that his knowledge does not depend on his being. People of Western culture put great value on the level of a man's knowledge, but they do not value the level of a man's being and are not ashamed of the low level of their own being. They do not even understand what it means. And they do not understand that a man's knowledge depends on the level of his being. If knowledge gets far ahead of being, it becomes theoretical and abstract and inapplicable to life, or actually harmful, because instead of serving life and helping people the better to struggle with the difficulties they meet, it begins to complicate man's life, brings new difficulties into it, new troubles and calamities which were not there before. The reason for this is that knowledge which is not in accordance with being cannot be large enough for, or sufficiently suited to, man's real needs. It will always be a knowledge of one thing together. to be formed without a knowledge of the essence of skill. Such preponderance of knowledge over being is observed in present-day culture. The idea of the value and importance of the level of being is completely forgotten. And it is forgotten that the level of knowledge is determined by the level of being. Actually, at a given level of being, the possibilities of knowledge are limited and finite. Within the limits of a given being, the quality of knowledge cannot be changed, and the accumulation of information of one and the same nature is an already known limit. Alone is possible. A change in the nature of knowledge is possible only with a change in the nature of being. Taken in itself, a man's being has many different sides. The most characteristic feature of a motive man is the absence of unity in the man. Further, the absence in him of even traces of those properties which he most likes to ascribe to himself, that is, lucid consciousness, free will, a permanent ego or I, and the ability to do. Surprise you if I say that the chief feature of a modem man's being which explains everything else that is lacking in him is sleep. A modern man lives in sleep. In sleep he is born and in sleep he dies. About sleep, its significance and its role in life, we will speak later. But at present just think of one thing, what knowledge can a sleeping man have? And if you think about it and at the same time remember that sleep is the chief feature of our being, it will at once become clear to you that if a man really wants knowledge, he must first of all think about how to wake, that is, about how to change his being.